I think the most important qualities to look for in someone we're going to spend our lives with, whether on a friendship basis or whether on a romantic basis. Number one is, what is that person's life goal? You know, sometimes we make decisions based just on religion. Oh, I'm this religion, that person's the same religion, therefore it will be a good match. The dilemma with that is that religion does not necessarily determine really how we're living our lives. There's a lot of people for whom religion is just ritual, whereas there's a lot of people for whom it's the way in to that truth of who we are. It's the way toward moksha, freedom, liberation, enlightenment. And so rather than asking only about religion, I would be much more concerned with, what is someone's actual goal of their life? Because if someone's goal of their life is just to make a lot of money or get really successful, and your goal is to live a really deep spiritual life, then even though you might be of the same religion, I don't think that would necessarily be a very smooth marriage or even a smooth friendship. Because we only get 24 hours in a day, we have to sleep some of them. Science tells us, you know, 6 to 8, some sleep more, some sleep less, but some percentage of our day has to go in sleeping. Some in bathing, some in eating. Then, of course, most people have to get a job, make some money. So there's a very limited amount of free time that we have to dedicate to whatever we want. And if you've got completely opposite ideas of the goal of life, then it's going to bring about conflict. So I would say the number one quality that I would look for in a friend or a romantic partner would be, what is the goal of their life? And does it match the goal of your life? Because even if someone says, well, I'm not very religious, let's say, but the goal of my life is to serve the world, to use every minute, every moment that I have in service, well, even if they don't necessarily do the same rituals you do or pray in the same way you do, that life goal is a life goal that is right in line with actually our teachings of Dharma. So that would be my first quality. The second quality I think that would be most important is someone who is very comfortable with you growing and blossoming and expanding and changing. See, when people have agendas that we be a certain way, stay a certain way, act a certain way, then all of our growth and transformation becomes a threat to them. So I would look for someone who was very open and even excited by the idea of change and growth and transformation, their own as well as yours, someone who wasn't threatened by that, someone who themselves was looking to grow and transform and who wanted you to grow and transform, someone who trusts your own inner knowing much more than they trust their own cultural or societal norms that say you must do X, Y, and Z. Because we've all got these kind of norms from society that say this is how we're supposed to live and this is what we're supposed to do. And it's the kind of stuff, you know, that we're supposed to do to make the neighbors jealous or so that the neighbors don't speak badly about us. It doesn't really have anything to do with anyone's dharma or anyone's life calling. And so I would want someone who was much more concerned with your own inner voice, your own inner wisdom, than what the neighbors were going to think, or what his or her parents were going to think about it, what the relatives would say. I would want someone who was primarily concerned with me listening to my own inner voice, finding it and listening to it, even if it wasn't something that was going to make the neighbors jealous, even if it was something the neighbors might, God forbid, not actually think was great. But that's okay. Nobody ever, you know, attained moksha because they kept their neighbors happy. Right? At the end of the day, whatever religion you may be, or whatever you may conceive of as that kind of, we've left the body, we're now in that next state. And whether you think about it in a more Judeo-Christian tradition of, you know, well, a more Christian way of heaven or hell, whether you think about it in terms of rebirth, reincarnation, our karma, whatever way you think about it, there's no way in which what we're being asked after our life is, you never made the neighbors uncomfortable, did you? The neighbors approved of everything you did, right? They were jealous a lot, right? Doesn't matter. So I would want someone who really was connected to what matters for themselves and also for me. The last thing I would want in a relationship is someone saying, yeah, I know your heart is telling you that, but oh my God, what are the neighbors going to say? Or what are my parents going to say? Or what are my relatives going to say? What's society going to say? I would want someone who was ready to be my ally in following what my heart said. And then lastly, I mean, there's so much I could spend all night on just that list, but I'd say lastly for now, I would want someone deeply committed to truth. There's a tendency in this culture being Indian culture, to be more concerned with the convenience of the moment than with actual truth. What is it that's going to go over easily in the moment? What can I say that's going to make people kind of just comfy in the moment rather than the ultimate truth? And on the one hand, you don't want ultimate truth at all costs. Sometimes it's very damaging. You know, in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says, tapas of speech is that which is true, but also that which is kind and beneficial. So it has to be true, but it doesn't mean that if it's true but neither kind nor beneficial, we speak it. But it also means that just because it's beneficial but not true doesn't mean we should be speaking it. And I mention this because what I've seen, I've got a background in psychology, and what I've seen in psychology and also in spirituality is what we call in kind of a legal jargon, the slippery slope. We begin somewhere, we take one step, and then we kind of slide. And someone who thinks it's okay, for example, you're supposed to meet people for dinner or somewhere. You're running late. The phone rings. You pick it up and you tell them, ki ha ham raslape. Ab raslape ni abgardpe. Nikalne ke liye tayari karve. But you've said, ham raslape. Now you think, well, it's better, it'll keep them happy, come se kam vo chintit. Right? They won't worry, they won't be stressed. But that would worry me. And it would worry me because of this slippery slope thing. Somebody who thinks it's okay to lie to our friends about the fact that we're on the way just because he or she doesn't want to face their disappointment when they say, what? You haven't left the house? My God, you're going to be late. That would worry me in terms of quality of a deep relationship. Because what it means is that they would be prepared to tell me things that weren't true just to avoid difficult situations or difficult conversations, just because they thought it was easier in the moment. And in any deep relationship, I would never want someone who just was looking to kind of appease me. But I would want someone who knew she wants the truth, whatever it may be. And then we'll deal with it. You haven't left home yet? Okay. Let's adjust our plans. But at least let's all be on one page of truth. So that little seemingly harmless habit of white lies would actually be a really big red flag for me on a personal level. So those would be my qualities that I would really pay attention to when choosing someone you're going to have a deep relationship with and one that you intend to last, at least this time, if not, as they say, seven lifetimes.